kind to say that we work on human rights, etc. But you know, very often I find myself looking at the mirror or lying in bed thinking late at night that really, what do I do in terms of human rights? Because our focus is very narrow. We work on systemic reform. When you think of the dilemmas of systemic reform, one of the dilemmas is someone comes to you, torture, bleeding, raped, hurt, and all you can do is refer them to someone like we here. And you don't take up that case because you're working on the system reform. Is that justified? Is that not justified? These are all the dilemmas that go through our heads all of the time. So I'm telling you all this, it wasn't actually written in my speech, but I'm telling you all this because I feel that we mustn't speechify, but we must talk and try to resolve the dilemmas of our own lives along with the dilemmas of the issues that we are connected with, so that we can talk honestly about these things. I really wouldn't like to put myself, I know he told you to clap, but I really wouldn't like to put myself on any pedestal that is beyond the place that you are sitting. I'm just standing over here because I'm short and I need to look up. So, with that, let me begin. I'm not going to rehearse all of the things that are wrong with policing. You experience them every day, you read about them every day. And across India, as I said, across many countries of the Commonwealth, and certainly in Maharashtra, the policing is no better and no worse than it was 5 years ago or 10 years ago. And this is worrisome. It may even be worse. There is little virtue in talking about repeating and repeating what is wrong with the policing. Both the public and the police themselves are suffering from the lack of reform. And this is also something that we need to recognize in order to be balanced in our approach. It is not sufficient to keep on beating up on the police, but rather to understand the context in which they are working, the accent, the society within which they are working. I don't offer this as an excuse. The police are always telling me that they cannot be any better than society. But I always respond to say that I do not see society, good people, ordinary people like you and I, reflected in the police. I do not wish to be at the level that we today talk about the police, in the way that we talk about the police. So don't club me in with that, don't club my colleagues in with that, don't club society in with that. There is something fundamentally wrong which has to be repaired. Now, there is great resistance to this repair. And the resistance is coming from both, from various places, and it is important to understand that. Where is the resistance coming from? It's coming from within the police itself, because everybody is comfortable. Not everybody, but a great deal of very active police people are comfortable with whatever they have. The patronage, the ability to do things round the corner. Even good policemen like to take shortcuts. And nobody holds them accountable for those shortcuts. So even good policemen are comfortable with the way things are, because they see that the context will not support them if they do it in a legal, lawful way. That is one of the things. Politicians, you know very well that the politicians want the police in their pockets. So they're not going to let go of such an enormous power base. Bureaucrats, because they're slow, because they're in competition, there is a sort of there is a rivalry between the police and the police and the IAS and the IPS. And you know, the sad thing is, in the fight of these elephants, the IAS and the IPS and the leadership and the elite and so on, the 85% of the police rank and file are crushed, like the grass underneath two elephants who are fighting. So, now, is that the only area of resistance? No. The public also are uncertain about what kind of policing they want. They don't know for sure if they want a police that is just effective in getting that man who is wrong, evil, don't ask questions, just whack him, get him out of my way, keep me safe. That's what they want, tough policing. Tough policing is often a sort of shorthand for illegal policing. Do the thing you have to do, we will turn a blind eye. And if you make a little money on the side, or if you rape somebody on the side, well, okay. Now that is changing. People are asking for more and more accountability. And this is the part that is being resisted by the police also. And it's also being resisted by the patrons of the police. So the public itself is not certain, it's ambivalent about the kind of policing it wants. Another set of the public, people like yourself, I think, we have to debate this out. And that debate, even that debate is not sufficient, has not begun with the vigor that it should have begun by now. There's another kind of policing that has proved to be successful. And when I say successful, I mean it has proved to be successful in fighting crime, in fighting terrorism, in fighting organized crime, and in winning the confidence of the people. And this, for shorthand, I'm calling democratic policing. Democratic countries need democratic policing. Now, what do we mean by democratic policing? Democratic policing is not law enforcement. It is upholding the law. Now, there is a difference between upholding the law and enforcing the law. When you're enforcing the law, it has a connotation that enforcement will be with unquestioned authority. But it assumes that the police have power and there will be little challenge to that power. On the other hand, the notion of upholding the law adds a dimension that in doing your duty, you are nothing more than a citizen in uniform. And you are bound by the law as much as anybody else is bound by the law. And if you break the law, then you are on the other side of the Lakshman Rekha. And on the other side of the Lakshman Rekha, you will be policed. You will be held to account. And that the good of society lies in this. And this is very important. That Lakshman Rekha is very, very important because the police, the army is another question. The army is supposed to not involve itself with the people, it's supposed to involve itself with the enemy outside. And it has its own rules and regulations. But the police are the only coercive force, the only lawful means of use of force. You and I may not use force, but the police can use force by law. And therefore, they need to be accountable. They need to be held closely. But how do you hold the police? That is the issue. So once you have the vision, then you go about creating the mechanisms of policing. Now, I often come across police people who blame everything on colonial rule. And I really think this is a crock. Because for 60 years, 67 years or whatever it is, we have had, there is no reason why we did not. I think it was a great mistake that at independence, we did not review how the police are structured. Militaristically, hierarchically, to a great discipline that requires unquestioned obedience. This was the colonial idea. Add to that our own feudal and casteist inclinations. And you have the police that you have today. Nothing has changed in the structure. Now, is it that we don't know what needs to be done? Even this is not true. We do know what is to be done. Commission upon commission has sat. I don't want to go into anecdotes, but 1862 is the Police Act. The states have the power to change these acts. The states have not done so, or if they have done so, they have adopted the model wholesale and made cosmetic changes, convenient, comfortable, but not really addressed the issue of citizenship, of rights. When there was the colonials here, there was no constitution. Now where you have a constitution that protects, what should be the vision and the role of the police? Essentially, the role of the police under the colonial was subdue the population, or at least make sure that they are in control. Intelligence gathering was very important. Who was on top and who was below was very important. So you had a color coding. White at the top, black below. And in the intermediate levels, little brown sides. And we have adopted that and kept it. What does that say about us?